So it's all about an update on the recent changes to refugee law and the determination process here in Australia. As you all know here, the ASRC is Australia's largest provider of aid, legal services and other services, casework, counselling, etc. to asylum seekers. We've been operating for 13 years. We have an office in Footscray. Obviously, this is our office in Footscray, and we have a much smaller office in Dandenong, which focuses on education and English and work placement. So today, as I've indicated, I will be providing an overview of the recent changes. The Caseload Act is the shortest way of referring to this new law, the new bill, and everything that comes with it. What the changes are and who does it affect. Different changes affect people differently depending on a number of different factors. What it means and what happens now for those who are affected. And as I said, we'll leave as much time as possible for questions. Having said that, I'm always happy to have questions pop up as they come, as they arise. So if something doesn't quite make sense, or we'd like a bit of clarification as we go, feel free to ask. That's fine. So the full name of this new law, Act, it is now, the Migration and Maritime Powers Legislation Amendment, resolving the Asylum Seeker Caseload Act. As you may know, most of the changes in this Act will predominantly affect those asylum seekers who came to Australia by boat, or who came by plane, arrived at the airport somewhere in Australia, but were not immigration cleared, which means they were not able to get through the airport on a visa and enter the community, enter the migration zone and apply for protection. So it's not just boat arrivals. There are a number of people who are in that situation. I've had several clients recently and over the years who haven't been able to get through the airport, have unfortunately advised the immigration officials that they've come to Australia to apply for protection rather than to study if they came on a student visa, or as to visit if they had a tourist visa. The purpose of that actual visa, if they say to the department, I actually am a refugee or I'm an asylum seeker, they'll have that visa cancelled and be placed in detention, and they will be they will be in the same category and affected in the same way as those who've arrived by boat without a visa. If asylum seekers have arrived by plane and passed through the airport, the process hasn't really changed. The process itself, the determination process, is as it always has been, in that there is an application form to lodge with the department for a protection visa, an 866 protection visa, and the RRT is the review body that reviews the decision by the department, a negative decision on that application. The Federal Circuit Court and the court system generally is there to review those decisions by the tribunal. And finally, the ministerial stage is the last stage in the process. So as it always has been, for those who have arrived by plane on a valid visa and have gone through the airport, the system hasn't changed. But it has changed for those who I've referred to who have arrived by boat and have not been immigration cleared through the airport, in that it creates a new process, a fast track process. A very significant change, and it introduces two new categories of visas, one of which, temporary protection visas, have existed previously up until 2007, I believe, and CHEVs, and I'll go through both these visas classes in just a moment. And also, it does change quite significantly some aspects of the refugee law test itself. And these are all very significant aspects of the Act. What's not mentioned in the Act, what isn't part of the law, but which was part of the process of it becoming law, was promises made by the Minister for Immigration with the crossbenchers in the Senate. These included granting work rights for those who hold a BVE, some of those who hold a bridging visa E, permanent pathways for those, the pathway to a permanent visa for those who are granted a Chev visa, and the possibility of travelling to a third country, not the country of origin, but a third country to visit family members in particular circumstances upon the approval of the minister. It also reduces some of our international law obligations, and I'll go through all of those points in more detail. So this is all very recent, obviously. On the 4th of December, the bill passed the Senate, and on the 15th of December, the Governor-General granted royal assent, and it became law. And having said that, there are different aspects of the Act that will commence at different times. So some of the new processes, like the fast-track process, will take a little bit of time to implement. And some aspects of the changes to the refugee law test may commence immediately in some circumstances, but it will be varied. In terms of work rights for BVE holders, one of the agreements made by the minister that he would start granting work rights to some holders of bridging visa E's. As I said, this isn't mentioned in the legislation or in the regulations. It's not mentioned anywhere that in which it can be enforced in any way by law. And it does mean the minister is the only person who can actually grant work rights to people who hold these bridging visa E's. The minister is the only person that has been able to sign off on asylum seekers who have arrived by boat or by plane and not immigration cleared, who are in immigration detention. He's been the only person to sign off on their release into the community on a bridging visa E. That's been the case for a number of years. He's also the only person who can change the conditions of any visa of that sort. So obviously, I'll get to it in a moment, but we're talking about a large number of people who potentially would be eligible for work rights, but he's the only person that can sign off on that to happen. So it will take time. And this idea that it would happen before Christmas, I think that was mentioned, is obviously bit of a furphy. Following on with work rights, as I said, for those who arrive by boat, so it's important to distinguish between where in the process they're at, and that will determine to some extent where the work rights may be granted. For those who have arrived by boat and have already been unsuccessful, have been rejected by the Department of Immigration, have been rejected by the Refugee Review Tribunal or another review body that existed previously. So they've been determined not to be refugees, and they're potentially at the court stage or at the ministerial stage, or exhausted all those options and have no options remaining. They're not eligible for work rights. The minister will not grant work rights to people in that situation. So it really is only for those who are at the department state, or who either haven't lodged at all and are waiting for the department to invite them to lodge their applications, which is a large number of people, or those who are at the department stage or the RRT, haven't been, I guess they term it finally determined as being not being refugees or being refugees, they are potentially eligible for work rights. Does that distinction makes sense? Okay. So here at the ASRC, we work with a large number of individuals who have exhausted either all of the different stages of the process or have gone through the RRT and are at court or the ministerial stage, they won't be eligible for work rights. Okay? That. So for those who are, there's no option of actually applying for work rights. That's not the way it's going to work because the minister himself has to use his power to grant the work rights. He'll do that, potentially, in time, but there is no time frame for when that will happen. And as I've indicated, because of the way this whole process is set up, that he's the only person who can do it, it will take potentially a long time to get through everyone. The 8101 is the no work rights condition that some of you may be familiar with. That's what has to be removed from their bridging visa for work rights to be granted. The department has indicated in their fact sheet, so publicly they've indicated recently that for those who have a job offer, if they can inform the department of this using this email and provide their personal details, IMI card number, they will be prioritised and their work rights situation will be prioritised. But, I mean, the reality is there may be a large number of people in that situation and it's still likely to take time. But for those of you who are working with our client group in various capacities, if there is a job offer, they can put that forward. Okay, so that's the work rights situation. Moving on to the fast track process. This is, as I said, a hugely significant change in the determination process. It's unprecedented in the Australian context, and it affects those who have arrived after a particular date. And I refer to boat arrivals, but again, also those who've arrived by plane and aren't immigration cleared. After the 13th of August 2012, those who've arrived after that date and who are caught up in the no advantage policy, that was the date that policy was introduced, these are the individuals that will be affected by this fast track process. Up to this point, with some exceptions, there are some exceptions, but generally, up to this point, all those who have arrived after that date and before the 12th of July, 2013, have not been able to lodge in a protection visa application, or if they have lodged, it just hasn't been processed. It's a large number of people that have had their applications either not accepted or not moving. Hasn't been moving. This is about to change. They will be affected by this fast track process. The minister has the power to deem other people outside this category to be fast track applicants, so it won't necessarily be limited to this group. The minister has a number of new powers to determine who will be processed in what way. And the department's indicated that individuals will have to be invited. So people in this category will receive letters from the department inviting them to apply for protection, probably within a specified date, I would suspect. With that letter, it seems that the application form will be enclosed to fill out, as well as information around how they should do it, some important aspects of how their case will be assessed, and then they will lodge that application back at the department. The department will assess the application and any additional information that's attached to it, like statements of claims, supporting documentation, submissions if there's lawyers who are assisting and providing legal submissions. It'll be assessed by the department delegate, a decision maker, and a decision will be made, and it seems it'll be made quite quickly, although there may be an interview before that decision is made. It's unclear at this stage. It's absolutely essential with this new process that all information, obviously where possible, this is very problematic in many situations, but all information in support of an application, all the claims that around why someone fears persecution if they were to return to their country of origin, is submitted at the start and part of that first application. Okay, late disclosure could create significant problems, which I will get to. But that is now a very important aspect of this. So if that application that's submitted is unsuccessful, the minister will have the power to refer those cases, some of those cases that he deems worthy, will be referred to a review body. Not the Refugee Review Tribunal. It's a new body, new statutory body that's created by this act. It's called the Immigration Assessment Authority. It's not the RRT, but it will be within the RRT structure, as in that it will be within their building, for instance. But it seems that the tribunal at this stage is unclear as to how it will operate and doesn't necessarily have as many details as one would expect. So the Immigration Assessment Authority, as I say, will only be available to those that the department and the immigration minister and his delegates decide should be referred for review. And the Act has stated that those claims, those applications that are rejected, that aren't seen to have credible claims, that don't have objective evidence to support those claims, documentary evidence, that are seen to be frivolous, will not be referred to review, and that will be the end of the process of the assessment of their claims. That will be a decision made by the department itself, a position within the department. However, that decision as to whether the application should be passed on or referred to the tribunal, the authority, will be reviewable by the courts. So the Federal Circuit Court will have the power to consider whether that decision contained an error of law, whether it was made properly. So it does mean that there will be a lot of litigation, and that will be significant for us as in the legal team and for lawyers everywhere to make sure that everyone, I mean, it goes without saying that everyone should have the right to review, a natural right to review. That's certainly our strong opinion. And for the department to exclude that right and to decide when it's appropriate for that review to happen, we will obviously make sure that there's judicial oversight to that decision. So that's going to involve the courts in a significant way. The IAA, as we'll be calling it, will be based only in Sydney and Melbourne. And so we suspect, there will be no hearing. So it'll be decided on the papers. If there is a review, unlike the tribunal now, at the moment at RRT, if the tribunal cannot make a positive decision on the papers, it has to have a hearing. Now, there will be no hearing, and it's yet to be, this isn't confirmed yet, but I don't believe, I'm not sure if there'll be a discretion to have a hearing or not. At this stage, it seems like there'll be just no hearings available. Generally we'll be without a hearing, so perhaps there will be discretion. It's also set out in the Act that the authority will not consider new information that has been provided or submitted after that first application or after the first decision by the department, unless there are very compelling reasons for that information to be considered. And that's very significant because from my experience, from our experience, it is extremely common for new information to come after that first application is submitted, even after that first interview by the department delegate and the first decision. There could be very good reasons why disclosures are made after that point, or information becomes available after that point. So this is a particularly concerning aspect of this process. As I said, the decision will be made on the papers generally, and if unsuccessful, again, the courts will be able to review the decision and consider whether there was an error of law. But like the Federal Circuit Court reviewing RRT decisions, the courts can't review the merits of the case, whether someone is or is not a refugee, or whether the tribunal or authority made a factual error. It's about, it's really a technical issue of whether there was an error of law, whether there was natural justice provided to the department, issues of procedural fairness, other aspects. So it is a very limited review at the court stage. So that's the fast track process, just in a nutshell. Just maybe mentioned later, but it seems that the number of asylum seekers in the community who are likely to be affected by the fast track process, so who are in that no advantage group, is around 22,000, and we suspect that around 9,000 are in Victoria. So we're talking about a very large number of people, and it's, again, this may be later in the slides, but there is no funding by the government for legal services to provide assistance at any stage in the fast track process. In the past, there was, before this government was elected, there was funding for what's IAAS, lawyers under the IAAS process to assist anyone who'd arrived by boat. Anyone in detention and everyone who'd arrived by boat automatically had legal representation at the department and the review stage. Now that's been abolished so that no one who is in that category will be eligible for funded legal assistance. But I'll get to that in a bit more detail in a little bit later. So temporary protection visas, this affects all asylum seekers who have arrived by boat, no matter when they arrived. If it was before 12th of August 2012, it doesn't matter. Anyone who arrived by boat whose case has not been determined, who have not been granted a protection visa already, will, if found to be owed protection by Australia, be granted a TPV at best. So that again includes those who've arrived by plane, either without a visa or not immigration cleared. Those who've arrived by plane with a valid visa, who were able to be immigration cleared, who applied for protection, as I referred to earlier, with an 866 application form, will not be affected by this change. Will continue to be eligible for a protection visa, a permanent protection visa. So that's obviously a large number of our members here. They will all continue to be eligible for that protection visa, permanent residency.
Simon, does that include the people who jump ship maritime arrivals?
That's a good question. Traditionally, those in that situation who've jumped ship are effectively in the same situation as those who have arrived by plane on a valid visa, because they come with a seaman visa. So even if they've arrived by boat, it's a different sort of situation. I believe that's still the case, but that's a very good question. But yes, that they should be in the same category as those who've in the second category who've arrived by plane with a visa. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Great. Okay, so the TPVs will be valid for up to 3 years. work rights, access to Medicare, study rights, I believe, will be included, although there's not really any mention. 5 to 18.
So
they will be eligible. They will be eligible, okay.
Age group.
Oh, right. Sorry. Yes. Yes. So those who are eligible for to go to school will be able to study, but we don't know about those who are adults or who are looking at perhaps tertiary education. There's no real mention of that sort of the study rights. It's the emphasis really is on work rights, and we haven't come across any clarification as to whether people will have the ability to study. Either TAFE or university courses who have a TPB.
Under the chef, that you have work rights if you go out to the.
Yeah.
So education as well, but I'm not sure how clear that is.
Yeah, I'll get to chefs in just a minute. It's also, there's not much detail on that visa either, but certainly work rights, Medicare, access to Centrelink support will be available. After the 3 years, or at some point leading up to the 3 years, of the expiry of that visa, that period, anyone on a TPV will have to again show that they demonstrate to the department that they continue to be refugees, they continue to be at risk of persecution upon return. There'll be another assessment at that point, and that will determine whether another TPV will be granted. And that's how it worked the first time around when we had TPVs, except that at the end of those 3 years, and if they showed that they did continue to have fears of harm, they were granted permanent protection visas. This time around, it will be another TPV. Yep.
During the 3 years, if there are other evidence that comes up that support them, would they be able to submit that?
That's unclear. It's good. Yep, that's a good point. All of those details are unclear at the moment. And one of the worst aspects of this act is that there will not be access to family reunion. And they will not be able to sponsor family to come to Australia. And there is the possibility, again, it's unclear as to how this will work, but there will be the possibility in some circumstances of applying for this different class of visa, this chef visa, when this chef visa is created, which it's not around at the moment. Yep, I'll get to that. It's a safe haven visa, but I'll come to give you a bit more detail about that. Travel on TPVs. So one other concession that I've mentioned already that was made by the minister, again, this isn't in the regulations or the actual detail of the act, but in compassionate circumstances, if family member is unwell, if there are compelling circumstances like that, it's been flagged that there will be the possibility that the minister may allow someone on a TPV to visit that family member in a third country, never in their country of origin. But written permission will have to be provided, and there's no detail as to how this will work. Now, safe haven enterprise visas, so it's, I forgot that word, enterprise, that's important. The chef visas, it's been flagged that they will be established in around or after April next year, and that they will be valid for 5 years rather than three. Again, the right to work, the right to Medicare, early health assessment and intervention services, social security, education again for school-aged children will be available, but again, family reunion will not be an option for anyone on a chef visa. For those, so the chef, the way it seems like it will work is that anyone who's been granted a TPV may have the right to apply for a chef visa if they wish to, if they satisfy the criteria of the Chev visa, and at that point they won't have another assessment of their claims for refugee status, so that won't be part of the assessment as to whether a Chev will be granted. The focus will really be more on that individual's work history or study history, if they have study rights, it's unclear, but especially work history, and particularly for those, it'll be available for those who have been working in a regional area that has been designated by the minister. We don't know where that will be at this stage, but that is the focus. So it's pretty clear what this is about. It's about getting people out into regional areas to work, to support those communities and have skills or experience that can benefit the communities.
That doesn't make sense. If those people were on visas that weren't given work rights, so how could they demonstrate that they...
Oh, no, once they've been granted a TPV. So they have to already have a TPV with work rights to then be able to apply for the Chev. This is a whole new visa, and it's taken me a little while to get my head around even what it's about and what will be involved. And I know there's not much detail yet, but does that make sense? It's okay.
Simon, is that permanent?
It's 5 years. Yep. But nice segue, Patrick, because permanent visas for Chev holders, another concession that seems to have been provided by the minister, we'll see, is that for those who are granted Chevs, there may be the pathway available to a permanent visa. There will be quite significant requirements for that option to be available. So at this stage, it's been flagged that there will have to have been a 3.5 year period living and working, living in a regional area and either working or studying, I believe, for that 3.5 years, and not having accessed Centrelink income support for more than 18 months of that period. So that balances out the 5 years when you think about it. If they have met that requirement, those requirements. There are a number of visas, I think 32 visas, some are permanent, some are temporary, that may be available to apply for. For instance, we've got some examples here. The temporary work skilled, the 457 visa, it's a very well-known visa, employer-nominated 457 visas. Partner visas, it's worth mentioning that the department has increased the cost, the application fee of partner visas, or actually all visas, but including partner visas by 50% as of 1st of January, which now means that it's up over $6,000 to apply for partner visa onshore in Australia. So, and that is increased regularly, so who knows how much it'll be in the future. Child visas and last remaining relatives. So some of these visas in the family stream, as well as a number of visas in the work category. And some of them do have most of them have a very high threshold in terms of the criteria that has to be satisfied to be able to apply. There's no detail yet as to whether there'll be other requirements for Chev holders to satisfy, but in themselves, these visas are not easy to get, basically. Most of them, well, all of them, really. Okay, so travel for Chev holders. So again, it's been flagged that Chev holders may be able to travel to third countries in compassionate circumstances, but with the written permission from effectively the minister. And there is no detail, again, as to how this would work. But I am aware, as you can imagine, that a number of people are very concerned about that point, you know, with family members who they haven't seen for a long time, even the possibility that it could happen is giving people hope, but we'll wait and see what the detail says. Okay, so that's TPVs and CHEVs. Moving on to another aspect of this act, which is very significant, which does actually affect all asylum seekers. This is the one aspect of the act that affects those who've arrived by plane or boat, anyone who's applied for protection or whose assessment by the department is around whether they are owed protection. They are all affected by these changes, which is some changes to the way that the refugee test, who is a refugee. This test has now been changed by this act in some pretty significant ways. Firstly, and some of it's a little bit complex, definitely, but one aspect is that there is a section of this act which states that it introduces there's more to it than this, but it introduces a requirement in some situations, very limited situations that we can't yet foresee, really. There may be a requirement to modify one's behaviour to avoid persecution in their country. Now, that was our reaction, yeah, a lot of open mouths and shock when we first read this, because... our focus in our submissions to the Senate inquiry, that's the potential consequence. However, there has been some clarification from the department, from the minister, that it will not affect situations where an individual may have to change aspects of their behaviour that would be considered to be immutable aspects of their of themselves. So, for instance, their sexuality, their gender, their political opinion, so fundamental
tribal,
yep, exactly. Their conscience, their religion,
ethnicity.
So in these respects, they will not be required, or it seems, and it's been clarified that they will not be. So it's very unclear what the purpose of that change is. No, this is all around the refugee test, so it's not complementary protection. It's very, very strange, and it's like we've been reflecting on our number of clients that we've assisted in the past, and we can't really envisage a situation that this could arise. So hopefully that will be the reality, that it doesn't really affect anyone. What will affect people, in it seems quite a, well, this will be a significant change to that will affect a number of types of cases, is changes to the relocation test. So at the previously, and in every other jurisdiction really, in the UK, Europe, US, everywhere really that I'm aware of, if someone is at risk in a particular area of their country, the question is whether they could reasonably and safely relocate to somewhere else in their country. This act has taken out that question of whether it would be reasonable, and now the test is purely whether it would be safe and whether there is any legal barriers to relocation within their country. That is hugely significant if it plays out the way we fear it might. Hugely significant for those who fear harm from a non-government entity like the Taliban in Afghanistan or Pakistan, or a woman who fears harm from her family or her husband, where decision makers have always considered the particular circumstances of the applicant and whether it would be reasonable and what impact there would be on the applicant if they were to relocate. They won't be doing that. They will be looking at whether there is a well-founded fear of persecution throughout the country. And if that can't be, for a refugee convention reason, if that can't be made out, and in many, many cases it just can't, because the reality is that, you know, the Taliban cannot necessarily control all aspects of situation in a particular country, they won't be found to be a refugee, potentially. So that's very concerning. It affects, as I've mentioned, all asylum seekers, plane and boat arrivals. In the sessions we've been giving to clients and will be giving to clients, we highly recommend, strongly recommend, that in relation to these changes, it's very, very important, if possible, to obtain legal advice in terms of how these changes will affect particular cases. So it's hard to speak generally around how this will affect a particular type of case, but broadly, I've indicated some examples. Does that make sense? Is that clear? We also have a situation where the Act has removed non-refoulement as a consideration when removing someone from Australia potentially to their country of origin. So non-refoulement is around returning someone to persecution, to harm. It also removes the ability of the court to consider international obligations that Australia has as a member of the international community, which has ratified, signed conventions like the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the Convention Against Torture, the Convention on the Rights of the Child. Courts have always considered these obligations when interpreting the Migration Act, basically. This specifically removes that option for a court, or the possibility for a court to do so. Especially where there's a situation at sea and the government, the minister, is potentially looking at returning a boat to the country that it came from, or the country where persecution is feared. So that was obviously the example that's obvious earlier this year, this boat with the Sri Lankan asylum seekers. Okay, so how does it affect our members, our non-members, all asylum seekers? There are three types of groups in the community who have arrived by boat. Those who have applied for protection already, where the minister had already provided the right to apply, and that's a large number of people who have applied for protection and whose applications are being assessed. Those who the minister has not given the right to apply for protection, but you applied anyway. And thirdly, those who haven't applied for protection. So firstly, if the minister provided the opportunity to apply for protection, as I said, this is a large number of people, and the application has been processed or is being processed, it will continue to be processed as it is at the moment. So if someone's case is at the RRT, it will continue to be at the RRT. If their case is at the department and waiting for a decision, I think it's unclear as to how that will now be, whether it will be going to the RRT or fast-tracked. I certainly don't know the answer to that. Some may, but in any case, if they are found to be a refugee or owed protection, they will be granted a TPV, even though at the time that they applied for protection, it was an application for a protection visa, permanent protection.
I have a large number of people who are at FCC.
Yep.
So they will not be included.
For those who are at the FCC, if they're successful at the FCC, the case will go back to the tribunal, the RRT. And the RRT will consider whether they are a refugee or owed protection. And if they are, they should be granted a TPV.
The normal process will apply to those.
I believe so, yeah.
Okay.
If the minister did not provide permission to apply for protection, but an application was lodged anyway, that application will now be made valid. It wasn't in the past, generally. And that letter inviting further information and acknowledging the application and advising that the application may be fast-tracked will be provided at some point. And again, if successful, a TPV will be granted. And what we'll be telling everyone at the information sessions, and which everyone should be aware of if you're working with clients, especially caseworkers, is it's absolutely essential always to inform the department if contact details change. I wouldn't say now more than ever, because it's always been critical, but as you can imagine, if they don't inform the department, they don't receive the letter because they didn't advise the department, well, they may have missed the opportunity because they won't get a second chance potentially. So third category for those, and this is probably the largest number of people in the community, those who have not yet applied for protection. And as I've indicated, the minister will be getting through this group and inviting those in this category to apply. And when he'll be doing so by in writing, so that's important to know. A phone call is not enough, and if you have an asylum seeker, a client come to you and say, I don't know if I've been invited yet, I received a phone call, I don't know what they were saying, remember to inform them that it has to be in writing so that they can show the letter and the letter can be explained to them. Okay. And the letter will include the application forms that need to be completed as part of the application process and other information that's needed. And it seems like there will be a request, a focus on identity documents. Any documents, any evidence that can be provided to substantiate the identity of the applicant. That will be a massive focus, and it seems that those who aren't able to provide that sort of evidence will potentially, I'm speculating, but struggle to have their case considered properly. There will be a massive focus on identity verification, I think. Okay, so what can be done now? So what can we advise our people, our communities to do right now? Right now, it's as I've indicated, keep your contact details up to date so that you receive the letter when it's sent out from the department. That's the first thing. And to do this, there's a phone number, as you can see, but as well as that, another option is to complete a form, change of contact details form. It's called a 929 form. You can download that from the immigration website. And the essential questions are 2 to 6. I don't have one in front of me, unfortunately. It's reasonably straightforward. The main thing is to really provide your personal details, your new contact details, and to sign it. And if you send it to that, I think I have an email address coming up, then they will update your details on the system. It's actually the email address I had previously around the work rights. I can't quite remember what it is. It's compliance, basically. The second thing is to obtain your immigration file. This is really, really important, and we will be advising everyone to do this, to start the process immediately. It will be essential to have all the information that the Department of Immigration has about you, essentially, about each person. And there is the legal right to access that information. And that is the way to do that is to, again, download a form from the website of the Immigration Department. 424A is the number of that form. There must be an identification, a copy of ID attached, so IMI card or driver's license or passport attached. That doesn't need to be certified, that copy of their ID. It's important. Unfortunately, I don't have this form in front of me, but there's a question that asks what information you are wanting. And it's important to ask for the entire immigration file. And if possible, if it's known what the file number is, to just include in relation to my file number, and it will be CLF 2012/13/a number. Put that number in, and the department will just put all the documents onto a disk or print them all out. And the FOIs can actually be, the material can be provided either in paper or on a CD or by email. So there is the option for any of those. So it's really important to have that file for lots of reasons, but one really important reason is that every single person who's arrived by boat will have been interviewed when they arrived on Christmas Islands. And that interview should be transcribed in that file. Whoever's deciding the case at the department or the IAA authority will look at what was in that interview, what was said in that interview. And I can't tell you how many times I've read cases at the later stages of the process where problems have started because there's been inconsistencies in what was said at that interview maybe 3-4 years ago and what's put in the application now. And so yes, it's very important to look at that in your file. Consistency of claims is something that is very important, and it's something that the decision maker is likely to look at. There's no cost to obtain that file, so there's no reason not to apply to obtain it. And it usually takes about a month for it to be sent through, sometimes longer. Okay, now, once the invitation to lodge an application is provided, the next step will be to complete the forms and begin the process of lodging. But it's certainly recommended to start that now. So for those of you who have clients who are in this situation, you could certainly encourage them to start listing all the addresses they've ever lived at, everywhere they've studied, all the courses they've studied, everywhere they've worked. Certainly, we would encourage, for those who are able to start putting together a statement of their story. Why did they leave their country? Why do they fear harm upon return? Not to get into the minutiae of it, but certainly what will be absolutely essential is to make sure that in that first statement attached to the application, every single incident in which they may have been harmed or threatened or had any contact with the authorities or the source of harm in their country is listed and detailed to some extent. It's very problematic when those sort of key aspects of claims are not mentioned first time around. That's just the way the process works, and it will be much more. That will be much more the case because it's all about early disclosure now. So, I'm bordering on legal advice now, but just something to be aware of, I guess. And documentation is an emphasis now. So any documentation that can substantiate any aspects of one's claims will be worth looking into and obtaining. Having said that, there's a major focus on bogus documents these days. And actually, that's the way they're defined. Bogus is the actual word used. So legal advice will always be, don't ever consider providing documents that you don't 100% know is a genuine document. That's critical. And identity documents, where possible, which I've already discussed. And where possible, consider finding a lawyer to provide immigration assistance. As I've indicated, the IAAS funding, the government-funded legal assistance, no longer exists for the category of asylum seekers we're talking about today, as in boat arrivals or those who are not immigration cleared to have arrived by plane. Having said that, perhaps unaccompanied minors, I'm not sure about that. We have a sheet ourselves that has a referral sheet for legal services, generally private firms or lawyers who we recommend. And I'll discuss how the Human Rights Law Program can help right now. So we will be facing a large workload in 2015, I think, or even larger. And we are looking at providing a response in multiple ways. Firstly, we will be holding workshops, legal workshops. We've started them already, as I've indicated, but we will be having a lot more in the new year. And during these workshops, we'll be discussing all sorts of things, but we will start getting towards how to complete an application, how to write a statement of claims, talking about documents, getting into the nitty-gritty information, not advice, but that will be a focus for us because of the numbers. I mean, as I've indicated, we're talking about 22,000 people in Australia and around 9,000 in Victoria at this stage. So we have 5 lawyers at this point in the legal program. So obviously, we'll be trying to be creative in how we can assist as many people as possible in a meaningful way. Limited assistance appointments. So that refers to actual appointments with the Human Rights Law Program to provide some sort of advice or assistance with things like completing application forms, writing statements, but not in an ongoing way. So not providing the ongoing service, not being listed as the migration agent for that particular client. Our night clinic on Wednesday nights provides assistance in this way, and since the 1st of October, early October, we have responded to, I think it's, well, over 100, an average of 27 referrals a week. So a large number of individuals needing legal assistance. And that will continue, and it will probably increase. But traditionally, we've also provided full representation, so ongoing representation for a particular client as their lawyer, as their migration agent, communicating with the department, the tribunal, at whatever stage. We continue to do that, but the reality is that that will become a more limited and exceptional situation, much more exceptional. The numbers speak for themselves, unfortunately, and we have to respond. And that means that it will be much less common for us to provide that full representation. That's the legal assistance we'll be providing. As well as that, we'll also be providing community legal education, which I guess is, you know, similar to the legal workshops, but more like what we're doing right now. What I'm doing, this is legal education, not just to clients, but to caseworkers, to anyone in the sector, but also to members of this organisation, as well as going to Noble Park and speaking to 500 members of the Tamil community, Afghani community, and providing as much information as possible in education. And policy and advocacy is a key focus of the program as well. We've provided in conjunction with the campaigns team, we've provided submissions to the Senate inquiries of every recent, relating to every recent amendment to the Migration Act, every bill amending the Migration Act recently, and there's been a number of them. This Act obviously was a key submission that we provided, as well as the bill relating to character cancellations, citizenship cancellations, and others recently. We've been responding to those and will continue to do so. And the legal program can assist plane arrivals and boat arrivals, all asylum seekers. People in detention, in immigration detention and community detention. People at any stage of the process, the department, the tribunal, the federal circuit court, the federal court, the high court, the ministerial stage, the IAA, the whatever they call how this new process will work, we'll be assisting everyone who needs our assistance and where we have capacity to assist. And, well, the flip side is we cannot assist people outside Victoria unless they're in immigration detention. I mean, the reality is that a client of mine recently has been detained in Maribyrnong. He's been transferred to Darwin. We don't stop assisting him because they've transferred him to another detention centre in another state. But otherwise, there are legal services like ours in other states in Australia. People with family reunion needs, so those who have a protection visa who are looking to sponsor their partners or their children, traditionally we have provided this type of assistance. We continue to do that to some extent. We will be doing that in a much more limited way, and certainly we'll probably be doing less and less of that, taking on less new clients in that respect because of the focus that we have to have on people affected by this act. And people at the Migration Review Tribunal. So for anyone who has applied for a non-protection visa, a partner visa, a skilled visa, a student visa, any visa that's not a protection visa effectively, who wouldn't go to the Refugee Review Tribunal or the Immigration Assessment Authority, the Migration Review Tribunal will be their tribunal. Look at their case. We don't do any work at the MRT. There are a number of lawyers, obviously, that do, who we refer people to. And to request assistance from us, as you would all know here, that's our phone number. And the email is legal_triage. We have as hopefully you all know, we have a desk at the front of the members area next to the GAP desk that is the legal triage desk that is manned by volunteers from 11 till 3 every day. And anyone can come and drop in, anyone who's not a legal client who needs assistance can come to that desk in person. And priority is always given to those with urgent deadlines, urgent legal deadlines, which are quite common, but we will, and we are, able at the moment to, well, we're doing our best to respond to requests within 2 weeks. I believe we're doing that at the moment, so we'll continue to endeavour to do that. Okay. Questions?